Come on up, Joe.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, everyone. I did have an incredible evening last night because, you know, I usually stay in hotels, and so Steve Spangler accosted me and he said, you can go stay with my friends. Well, I'm leery about visiting people because I'm not a very kind guest. Last night I had to finish my talk by putting my pictures together. So I relented and I went to this place in Chula Vista and I was accepted with such incredible hospitality. Frank, if you're here, and Gene and his wife, Frank's wife, thank you very much for having me at your home. So I rested up a few hours and I think I'm ready. Now it's 9:15, Tom.
Are you up until 10:30?
I have until 10:30. No. Okay. Excuse me here.
More.
What is this about? The first thing is I thought children loved to eat fruit. And I've only seen one child here running around, and I don't even know if that child is eating fruit. There is a generation, and there's a second generation of people here, but to my chagrin, there are no children. Now, I've gone around the table and I've introduced myself to a few people and I've made a couple notes. First of all, we're kind of a nerdish group of people, but it's an aberration to think of it that way because the reality is we should be the huge crowds gathering because we're talking about essentially the sustenance of life, food. The fact that people gather to watch people hold wooden sticks and hit little balls and the tens of thousands amazes me. It's not because they don't appreciate the cultural tradition of baseball, but it doesn't feed anyone, it doesn't create anything, and here we are, a bunch of creators appreciating our synergy with nature, and we talk about all the biggest problems on the planet, but no one really gives a damn about them, because otherwise there would be thousands of people here instead of a few hundred who just are marginalized by their peculiar interest in knowing where their food comes from. My grandmother and my aunts, we used to gather when she was still alive 10, 15, 20 years ago, and she would have canning parties in the summer. And so my grandmother and my grandfather, as you know, society changed, they made their own notes of the aberration. They said, why in the hell do people care about labels on the food? Why don't they just make their own? And you think about it, so detached are we from the source of our food that we have to invest in political campaigns to fight large corporations to know what is in our food. I mean, when we canned tomatoes, if there was a blonde hair in it, we certainly knew who it was because only Aunt Babybel had blonde hair. The point is that we're awfully detached from food, and children are detached from nature, so much so there is a book that has been printed called The Last Child in the Woods, and it talks about nature deficit disorder, NDD. That's a new one. Kids are going home, they're sitting on the couch, or they're in front of the computer, and they don't connect with nature. So it is something to say about all of you. There should be a lot of kids here. I started when I was a kid, and I imagine there's quite a few of you who were inspired by your grandparents or your parents to love nature and even be here today. If you ask what gave you the incentive, the connection, it's us to the next generation. So there should be kids here. And they should be worried about the future just like we are, but not in a worrying fashion, not with anxiety, but just because it's so fascinating. So what I'm going to show you today is a poultry collection of my discoveries around the world. They're not my discoveries because people's past had discovered them long ago, but they're discoveries because, personally they're discoveries, but they're also opening a world up to you. I've heard the gentleman who was up here giving the award say that he had seen a lot of fruits in his life and he was surprised to see new ones. Even today, after doing this for almost 30 years, when I find new fruits, it only continues to tell me how wonderful and marvelous nature is. So, I'm going to get started. I've been criticized by my critiquers to get into the meat of the story quickly. Here's what you want to do. There are no names written on this. This is not a high-powered PowerPoint. It's not graphically laid out. I'm going to show you slides, good old-fashioned slides, and I'm going to try to make them emotive with my own feelings. So that means you won't see names, and if you want to have the names of what I'm going to talk about, there is a catch. GreatGardenSpeakers.com. Why do I care about this? Because this is a critique service where you, as listeners, can critique me as a speaker, and why do I want that? Because I don't want to just speak to nerdy fruit people. I want to go to commend commencement activities at major universities. I want to go in front of Congress. I want to tell people about what the future of food really is, and not from some corporate standpoint or from some agro-industry perspective. So the point is, we need to get the message to bigger groups of people, and we need to make it palatable to larger groups. And the one way you climb that ladder is by having critiques. So if you want a PDF and a PowerPoint of this presentation, I will send it to you, but only after I see that you have given me a critique. So that's no money involved, but it's your effort to take the time and critique me. GreatGardenSpeakers.com. I'll tell some other things as we go through here. Deserts, that's what this is about. I mean, you're supposedly in a major drought. There's reckoning that a great El Nino will be coming your way. But nevertheless, in many parts of the world, there are really, really dry areas. Atacama Desert, Sahara, all these deserts of the Middle East and in the Gobi and down in Australia. Part of the story about life, then, is people surviving in their environment. This is the key to what I have discovered, is people down through the centuries and the millennia have used plants all over the world. So when we hear about desertification, about global warming, about climate change, and the supposed elevation of temperature, we get all scared until we think and get rational that there are deserts all over the world that have been damn hot, and they've been that way for thousands of years. And guess what? Science is even proving it. They had to do a white paper. You know what a white paper is, where scientists come up with all kinds of experiments, and they do research, and they print it in a scientific journal, peer-reviewed, and they were studying desert plants in the Sonora Desert. And lo and behold, these desert plants did not seem to be suffering from climate change because they were already used to 160 degrees at the surface in the middle of August. So in other words, we have plants that are already adapted to a hot environment and already will produce food, and that's part of what I'm going to open up today to show you. Cacti. North America, Central America, South America. This is a family of plants, some 2,000 strong, that I contend is going to be the future of desert orchards. There are a few of us in this crowd who are passionate about cacti fruit, among them the dragon fruit, pitayas. I know that tomorrow, or today, Dennis Sharman is going to talk about the blueberry cactus, Fertilocactus. But there are hundreds, if not thousands, of species of cacti that can be improved and that will produce incredible fruit. If you think about the desert Southwest, you think about Arizona, the saguaro is a plant that has produced fruit for the natives for thousands of years. This particular bizarre looking plant grows in the Magdalena Plain in Baja California and is known as Stenocereus eruca. That's my little son Dimitri harvesting a fruit which is about the size of a medium-sized apple. It's undomesticated, it was harvested, but no one has spent any time improving it. So why am I so interested in young people and children? Because those, also ourselves, have the potential to change the world by taking nature and coddling it, investing time and effort and passion in creating new varieties. Think of Luther Burbank. For those of you here last night, I talked about Luther Burbank. So Stenocereus eruca grows on sandy plains in southern Baja California. This is called Pinocereus. It is an amazing cactus, of which there are several species that grows in Mexico and the southwest of U.S. down to Texas, and they produce edible fruits and edible tubers. This is a Pinocereus grevii, which was harvested in Arizona, and the tubers get up to 80 pounds. And I've eaten them, and they are fantastic, like eating a yam. So you have cacti that actually produce both edible fruits and edible tubers. And the question is, why is no one planting or considering or cultivating or improving these amazing plants? Various pitayas, these are often lumped together as dragon fruit. I mean, those are coming from Colombia, but just to have a panoply. One of our illustrious men here, Edgar Valdivia, and his dragon fruit project, and I think last night I made mention of what he had done. This right here is called Cirrus peruvianus. Now, Cirrus peruvianus, you probably have seen them growing around Vista and around Southern California. And what most of you will notice is that the fruit, when they mature, they dehisce, they break open. And that dehiscence is not making it a very commercializable fruit because, you know, when it's ripe, it breaks open. And for the most part, the fruits of Cirrus peruvianus are insipid. I mean, it's like eating fluffy, wet cardboard. This right here is a different story because Yossi Mizrahi and Beersheba Israel, who also has worked had been breeding these with the intention of breeding varieties that did not break open when they matured, and that means they were shippable. And then his other objective, to select and search for flavor. So that variety right there that Yossi Mizrahi is growing in this orchard is spectacular. In fact, they're even exporting them. There's Yossi right there. This right here is in the Bombaceae, the Bombax family. This is Sabo parviflora, and what it does, it has edible tubers. I call it the rhinoceros tree. That's my son, Peter, there in the Tehuacan Valley of Oaxaca. These giant dinosaur-looking trees produce edible seeds, a part of the kapok that so many of you are familiar with. The seed can be roasted as peanuts, and then large edible succulent tubers at their base. So it's very interesting how many plants have dual purposes. This right here is in the Agaveaceae family. This is a Vesprenaria. Vesprenaria does particularly well along the Mediterranean cooler coast of California. They don't take very much frost, they take a light frost. This clump of specimens was growing on Pico de Orizaba in Veracruz, Mexico. Now what's interesting about it are the flowers. Blooming every year, unlike the agaves, which die after they bloom. These beautiful green flowers are incorporated into omelets and are a special ingredient of food there. So imagine, you have this beautiful ornamental plant, but at the same time, which is drought resistant, but at the same time producing spectacular edible flowers that are great vegetables. There's a huge family and a huge genus known as Ipomea. So that includes Ipomea batatas, which is a sweet potato. These are glorified sweet potatoes grown in the Sonora Desert, which produce edible tubers. So not only do you have this extraordinary ornamental plant with a beautiful giant flower with a perennial tuber, but you can grow it in the most desertic of conditions. This right here is a Matalea. It grows in Sonora and used to extend up into California. These pods can be roasted and were roasted by the Seri Indians and are delectable, kind of like roasted artichokes. This right here is Pinus martinezii. It is the largest pinyon pine in the world, except for a similitude species which grows on another part of the planet in Afghanistan. This huge cone gets about a foot and a half long, that's my brother Patrick in Oaxaca, and it produces a pinyon pine nut about an inch and a half long. Now we collected seeds of this, and it's only recorded region in the southern part of Zacatecas, Mexico, about 10 years ago, and we have seeds that ended up in South Africa, that ended up in Ethiopia, that ended up in California and Arizona, and other parts that have similar climates around the world, and they grow very quick. This is a 15-year-old tree that's been planted in Oaxaca, and it's already producing these amazing pinyon cones. So the largest pinyon pine nuts in the world, and the largest pinyon cone in the world, Pinus maximartinezii. And it has extremely ornamental bluish foliage as well. Cacti again, this is the hedgehog cactus, Echinocactus. In West Texas, they also call it the strawberry hedgehog. These can be planted in plantation form and in strips because, of course, they're perennials. And they will produce a plant of that size, if it's guarded from the animals that feast on these, will produce upwards of about 3 or 4 quarts of fruit. And they are absolutely astoundingly delicious. Why is no one raising strawberry hedgehog cactus? Beautiful plant to grow and beautiful fruit. This is a top chef, and top chefs are important to my work because they're the ones who often find the practical elements of discovering really weird, amazing fruits and vegetables in the most obscure parts of the world. This chef right here is Marco Westmas. He ran an extraordinary restaurant near Den Haag, Holland, and what he has here on the table is the catch that I brought back from Madagascar, including a tuber here, which he, when he did the testing of it in his kitchen, he was so astounded, he said he never had anything like it in his life. It had the consistency between a jicama and a watermelon. So kind of crunchy, but kind of soft. And it had the tendency to absorb any flavor that was put on it and still maintain its integrity of character, of crunchiness. So he was amazed by this. What is it? It's called Dolichos fauncei. And it comes from the southwestern part of Madagascar. This was a miracle that I found this thing. There is a book, which is a two-series book published by a press called Strawberry Press that was written by Dr. Werner Rau, and it covered all these obscure succulent and caudiciform fat, you know, succulent plants of the semi-deserts and the shrub areas of Madagascar. And Dr. Rao had a picture of this laying on a piece of newspaper in a little town called Amplifini, which took us 3 days to go approximately 70 miles on a dirt track to get to. There I am in the forest. We found this is a thicket forest in southwestern Madagascar. The young man who took me there is this guy here, and he was able to thump on the ground and find these tubers growing down below. No one grows it, no one knows about it, it's never been cultivated. It's my inspiration to get people growing it all over the world. Look at that, just fascinating plant, unknown to 99.999% of the world. There's a tuber getting ready to ship back to Holland. These are very interesting plants, and your ears will pike up when you hear about them. I had a driver who was going around to all the hotels in Madagascar. One morning he comes out, and it was about 9:30 in the morning. He hits the dash, and he's kind of angry. I said, "Well, what's the matter with you?" And he says, "I only went 7 minutes." And I looked at him, and I said, "Well, what do you mean you only went 7 minutes?" He said, "I could have gone an hour." And then I started to realize what's going on here. And so he had a mistress at the hotel, and he said, "If I would have had my handy, I could have gone an hour and a half." And I said, "Well, what's your handy?" And so he ended up shipping me this up to Antananarivo, this bark here, which is a species of tree that grows in the southwest, which has been used by the Malagasy for hundreds of years as it has pro-sexual, let's call it, properties. It's called Neobegma mahalensis. And it's used with grevillea right here, another species, in a concoction in water, and it's drank by men. And it, to say the least, it works. But not as you're expecting. It is not Viagra. What it does is it suppresses climax. Good, there's no kids in this audience. This plant was taken by a Swedish company. They had discovered this, and it's a new trend called biopiracy. Maybe you've heard about it. There's a lot of biopiracy that goes on in the world, and there's very few people who can reckon that it exists because they don't know the rest of the story. Well, I found the Swedish company was trying to get a 100-country patent on the discovery of this wonder plant and its properties by saying that the Malagasy say everything's an aphrodisiac, and so they discounted it. But you'll have to get the rest of the story. Here I am in Oman, in the province of Dhofar, that's D-H-O-F-A-R, and I'm sitting there on a sleuthing mission, because part of what you do when you're a botanical explorer is you make a fool of yourself by going to see gentlemen like this and saying, through a translator, "Where can I find this plant?" And they look at you and say, "Why in the hell do you want to find that plant?" And so this right here is called Cibarrhiza macrorhiza, or Cibarrhiza dhofarensis, and it has a legend around it, not aphrodisiacal. It turns out that it is an incredible tuber in the milkweed family, and it has sweet-tasting leaves, it's represented, and the tuber is snow-white, and they say like a virgin who's ready to be betrothed. And so this plant is very, very endangered because of heavy grazing in the southern province of Dhofar, and it just happens to be that thanks to a collector by the name of Thomas McClure, who is a succulent collector, that these seeds made their way to California, and somebody's growing them right now, and I am getting plants from it. I've been looking for this plant for 8 years. These, they aren't cat turds. What they really are Verstania fetida. I call it the Dhofarian horseradish because it's a very, very piquant, very acrid taste. But for those of you who are adventurous in spices, will find it amazing. Dhofarania fetida. So they'll take these plants, they'll grind it up like green wasabi horseradish, and they'll put it on their food. Very, very pungent. Here I am with a species of, sometimes I lose it. What is this? This is, have a look at this. Anyone know what this is? Sorry, I forget once in a while. This is, it's called Rangia. I can't remember right now. Okay, let's go to this. This is Caralluma flava. Carallumas are succulent milkweeds. So what's so interesting about these, everything I'm showing you is a plant adapted to xerophytic conditions, desert, dry, arid, hot. This Caralluma flava is in the milkweed family and is a succulent. There it is right there. You can eat the stems, and I've eaten them, and I love them. They're tasty, they have somewhat of a sweetness, somewhat of a lingering bitterness, but they're really amazing. You can cook them up. This is Echinopsis, another succulent milkweed from the desert of Oman. Okay, what is this? This is beauty. The women of Oman use this type of plant which stains the tongue purple because purple tongues were considered beautiful. So I chewed up this plant, and of course for 3 days I had a beautiful tongue. This is Gladiolus usambensis, which grows in the wilds in Oman, and it is a gladiolus species. There it is in the plate in the plants of Dhofar. And what they do is they roast it on a dung pad. So they roast it, and then they put a kind of a butter in the little receptacle, clay receptacle that they're placing on top of the dung pad as it's roasting. And they are absolutely luscious, a true delicacy. There is my Bedouin's buffet. I had an uglier picture for some of you last night. Again, let's point out, these succulent things are all in the milkweed family, right here. So right here, these are all in the milkweed family, even this right here. That's Pentatropsis nivea. This right here is Glossinema variens. This is Reticulin fluoride. This up here is Caralluma quadrangulata and Caralluma flava and Caralluma quadrangulata. All incredible, amazingly delicious vegetables. No one knows about it. Echinopsis, again, another milkweed family. These, I did not eat. They're very bitter. They're precursors and relatives of ancient watermelons. These are limes over here, and there are wild cucumbers still in their acrid, very bitter stage. They have what are known as the very bitter alkaloids that make them that way, cucurbitacin. There's another luffa relative, Luffa operculum. So very interesting things. This is a caper. For those of you who are familiar with the capers that we eat, that's actually the salted preserved bud of Capparis spinosa. This is the species which has a much larger fruit, which turns orange and can be used as a spice as well. So this is just what the Bedouin buffet is. And then primogenal melons. This is Cucumis nilo in its wild state. Imagine they're about as big as a walnut. We see them domesticated, which tells me to tell you that if we take wild progenitors and see how they were and realize how they are, we can do a lot by domestication. Now, a lot of people ask me, well, Joe, you're talking about domestication, you're bragging it up, but isn't that a really long process? Didn't corn take tens of thousands of years to domesticate? Well, here's my example from modern day horticulture, and let this sink in because it will give you some inspiration and some hope that you don't have to die before you can do something. Turns out that the Dutch are the world's greatest houseplant people. They're also the world's greatest flower people. Holland has 16 million people, but has 25% of the gross agricultural exports that the United States has. 16 million people opposed to 300 million plus people. It's an amazing proportion. That means the Dutch are really good at what they do. So the Dutch went into the forest, into the jungles all over the world, and they found bulbs and flowers and bromeliads and anthuriums that were wild species. Yet through modern horticulture, not using GMO and genetic manipulation, they were able to create these incredible bromeliads that have these fluorescent pink and orange stripes because they selected and they bred. So that's the fast track example through floriculture of domestication. What if we took those little tiny wild melons, started breeding them back and forth? It may be only a few decades before we domesticate as opposed to the way the ancients had to do it. This right here is a plant that was growing in the nursery in Vista, California, of a nursery which is famous as the Rarity Busters. It's called Whitesonia crassa, which means Whitesonia is named after the gentleman who described it, crassa meaning big or fat. So this was the holy grail of the succulent collectors for years and years. It comes from Somalia. Actually, it comes from an area called Puntland. I haven't been there, but it isn't as dangerous as the area south near Mogadishu. In Puntland, these grow under bushes. These are what we call adventitious succulents. They hide in under the shade of a little bush, and the nomadic shepherds pick them and eat them like cucumbers. They're extremely rare. So it's a very interesting plant. I got seeds of it and got it to a nursery, and they started growing them. I kept asking if I could eat them, but at a price tag of $50 to $100 a piece, it was more valuable than the trouble. Now we're in Chile. So Chile has a lot of aridity. There's, of course, the Atacama Desert. There's many zones of Chile that are very dry. For those of you who aren't familiar with the Acadia, How many people know the acacia and quinata fruit? Yeah. Kind of an insipid purple fruit. That's one that needs to have some efforts to enhance its flavor. Well, this is in the same family, Largivalaceae, and this is the Largivalia, which this is the Malflower. I don't have a picture of the fruit. It's kind of finger-like, and it's eaten in, they call it a chocolate fruit in Chile. This is a very, very, very rare fruit, almost extinct. It's called Gomerteca caeuli, and it's actually reputed to be somewhat hallucinogenic. It grows in only a small area on the coast of Chile. I drove my girlfriend crazy, as I do most people, trying to find Gomerteca caeuli. It was a three-day episode interrogating everyone and anyone that I could even talk to as to the whereabouts of this bizarre fruit. It tastes kind of like the shell of a green walnut with a suffusion of apricot, and if you eat too many of them, you start hallucinating. So what a wonderful fruit. And there it is right there. Another fruit, there's the seed, and this is the spectacular fruit which should be grown here. It's called Geoffroea decorticans. It's wonderful in the sense it's like a dried jujube, so it's kind of pithy and pulpy and dainty. I mean, it has more powdery aspect to it. The seed is also edible, and it will grow in very deserted conditions. Now, at the Bryce Thompson Arboretum outside of Phoenix, there is a collection of small fruit in Geoffroea decorticans. These are quite large, some of them as big as a reasonable sized jujube. These right here, for example, about an inch and a half. And that's in the Atacama Desert in San Pedro, Chile. Again, prosopis. In Chile, there's two species of prosopis, which is in the acacia family, that produce wonderful food. Traditionally, very few the people are still collecting them. These taste like bananas. So if they take the flour that they get from grinding it, they taste just like bananas. And there, a French woman had to be inspired. She came to San Pedro Atacama, set up a restaurant, and her success in using traditional plants was so great that the natives took notice and started, you know, harvesting them again, because she was making ice cream and making a lot of money and all kinds of stuff. So there's Prosopis alba and Prosopis chiliensis in these two photos. Again, going back to cacti, people say, well, you know, it could get pretty harsh if we have climate change. I said, baloney, look at this, 15,000 foot elevation, so dry there's nothing growing except these little clumps of cacti, Mayhuanopsis bolivianus. It produces an edible fruit at 15,600 feet elevation in a virtual desert. They spread themselves out, look at where they are over there, because they can't grow too close to each other because there's not enough water. There's another species of Mayhuanopsis, these clump-forming cacti at high altitude, and there's an example of one of their fruits. Lots of seeds, but remember, even the seeds are full and rich in oil and omega-3s and everything. They can be processed. So you can actually harvest food at 15,000 feet in a barren desert. So I can test people who tell me that they can't feed the world. Here's another Mayhuanopsis that some of you saw this picture last night. It's Brownangia candelabra, and it looks like that candelabra in its description. And for those of you who were here, you already know the story, but for those who weren't, look at the disparity of plants. So dry is this at 10,000 feet elevation in the Atacama that their systems can't support more than a few plants around. Produces a large apple-sized fruit. Why aren't we growing that? This is Eulichnia. Eulichnia acida, this is a natural spontaneous plantation in central Chile. And these particular plants produce a gorgeous fruit, which is about the size of a kiwi, has a spineless skin. And what's inside is a delectable kiwi-like acid fruit that is not sweet, but yet lends itself perfectly to eating and incorporating salads. Cacti fruit all over the two continents, North and Central and South America, are really offering extraordinary potential for domestication. This is a plant which grows down in southern Arizona. It is called Amaurusia palmatifida, or Amaurusia palmatifida, I think it is. And the flowers are edible, the seed, the fruit is edible, the leaves are edible as a pot herb, and the root is edible, and you can roast the seeds as a coffee. No one's doing anything with this desert perennial. You can even take cuttings of it and propagate it. So this is another really high one on my list. It's called Sayala as well in certain languages of that region. It's a plant that no one knows about.
Can you spell it?
If you give me a critique.
Okay.
Okay. So I'm going to put put it all there. You guys are going to give critiques. I'm going to get 150 critiques today. That's what's going to be great. This is related to the papaya. How many of you know about Hakaratia? Hakaratia, you know about it, Stephen. Yeah, we'd have to have you pull out of the crowd. Hakaratia Mexicana. Now, you know about Moringa. Many people know about Moringa here?
Yes.
Okay, so Moringa is a plant genus that comes from the Horn of Africa, that's Somalia, Ethiopia, from Madagascar, and it said that it was also in India. So several species, about 7 to 12 species of Moringa. Recent genetic research tells us that Moringa is closely related to papaya. So now they're putting those two families together. And if you think about it, if any of you have eaten a papaya leaf or have chewed up a papaya seed and have chewed up moringa, there is even a taste similitude. So this right here is a deciduous relative of the papaya and hence of the moringas. Moringas will form very fat, as we call it, caudex type of stumps. So this is Hakaratia Mexicana. It's called the borolo, or a borolo. It produces a giant winged fruit that has the look of kind of a caramelized papaya. It's kind of more caramely looking than a papaya. Very sweet, very delicious. It's a winged fruit, and I don't have a picture of the fruit to bait you for further interest, but it really is an amazing plant. And in nature, the fruits are hanging on the barren trees because they flower during the season prior, and the fruits develop on the barren trees. So it's a really unique looking plant. There's another one of them. And this is in an area near Nizanda in the Isthmus of Oaxaca. Here I am eating fruits of Yucca potosina in San Luis Potosi, Mexico. A really incredible fruit. Now we jump to Madagascar, and these are called Banguerias. Banguerias are subtropical fruits that will produce a very interesting subacid, almost tasting like a sweet tamarind, for those of you who are familiar with it. And there's two species. There's this one and this one right here. So Banguerias, next on the list. Okay, the jackfruit. This would do really well in this part of California. It is a cucurbit, meaning it's in the melon and cucumber and watermelon family. This is called the jackfruit, G-A-C. Now the reason this is so extraordinarily interesting and also pokes a hole in some of our modern efforts at innovation is that it was used for thousands of years as a nutritive fruit. Inside, if I would have had a picture of it, which I don't, because I already have 139 pictures, you would see a blood red aerial that's flesh around the seed that was used by the Vietnamese, the Laotians, the Cambodians, the Thai, as they prepared rice. In incorporating this into their diet, they added vitamin A to rice that was polished. And so children did not suffer the carency of vitamin A. Well, come a hope that we bring things like food coloring to the world, and the people get lazy because they were inspired to color their rice, because white is the color of death, as they say, and red is the color of life. So they're eating red rice more because of its aesthetic properties rather than considering the token benefits of eating this particular fruit. So children were becoming vitamin A deficient. Well, in step Monsanto or some of the big companies, we're going to do breeding programs, we're going to create golden rice. So the point is, after they did it, after they modified rice and incorporated the yellow into it, they would have to eat 20 pounds a day to get the same vitamin A that you would get by having a serving of this. So in other words, you could not supply enough vitamin A in that rice to change the vitamin A deficiency in children, yet nature already had a solution. So these can be grown here. They're both male and female plants. People who have grown them have lamented to me that they will not set fruit. Well, they won't set fruit because there's not the proper pollinator here. And what you need to do then is pollinate it by hand, and they will set lots of fruit. This right here is Iliognis tokenensis, growing in hot, semi-arid regions of Vietnam. It's clonal. Iliognis tokenensis, very interesting. Now we go to Namibia, Botswana, and South Africa. This right here is Gravia flavescens. Gravia flavescens, it's known as the bushberry, and the Kalahari bushmen harvest these and they eat them right out of hand like little jujubes. What time is it? Let me check my time here. No, I have more than 10 minutes. Because I started at 18. I started at 9:18. They did it to me.
36 okay. minutes.
I'm fighting for my right. Okay, so here we are with a Makatan. Makatan is a variety of watermelon from the Natal in Africa. I had looked for the Makatan for years. I just wanted the Makatan. So when we're driving along and I see these ladies and I run up to their little stand and I start jumping up and down, singing and laughing, and they just thought I was insane. I mean, this guy is just going freaking berserk over a Makatan. Well, a Makatan is really special. See, they started dancing with me. I didn't even know why. We have a video of it. They're like jumping up and down and screaming, and I'm doing the same thing. So this Makatan is a very, very dense melon. I mean, it's almost like wood in its density. I was just at a man's house in Devon, Pennsylvania, by the name of W3, William Boyce Weaver. Try to have that for a name. So William Boyce Weaver is an American food culturist, and he's a writer of incredible renown in the food world. And he had a Makatan sitting on his table because he had also been in search of the Makatan. It is, the one he had was about 12 inches, maybe 14 inches, and weighed over 40 pounds. That's how dense they are. So this Makatan is used for its flesh, which they cook as a vegetable or they use as a preserve. So it's not like the citron melon, which is much much airier and fluffier. This is a dense, meaty fruit. And it is a watermelon, Citrullus lanatus, but it's just another variety or form, the Makatan. All right, I'm cutting it up at our camp. So then we get to other cucurbit members of the cucumber family. This is Cucumis africanus. That's Cucumis dipiceus. Now, in those two species, there's a clouding between domesticated or selected varieties and wild bitter ones. And so this is something that's really an uncharted world because there exist varieties that have been kind of promoted. I call it tended foraging for those of you who were here last night, meaning that the indigenous people will like find a good one and they'll kind of like go back to the same place every year and they'll kind of like weed out the bad ones. So that's kind of a selection that after thousands of years can actually result in domestication. So some of them are very bitter and toxic because they have high levels of the alkaloid cucurbitus in them. Others are very nutritious and taste good. Same with Cucumis dispaceus. This right here is Harpagophyton procumbens, which is also known as cat claw or lion tail. Here's Jake, one of the guys on our film team, showing them. Here's one in hand. Now they also call it the lion crypt because the rumor is they will set these huge seed pods around the camp. The lions will step on them, and the way the claw is of that fruit, it will clasp into the pad on the bottom of the lion, and you can't get it off because it kind of springs back. This is Coccinia. messed up on it last night. Coccinia sisifolia. Which is another cucumber family member that they eat as the borbolojo in Namibia. There's a ripe fruit there. There's a green fruit. There I am with the cat claw on my face. It's also used, Harpagophyton procumbens, as a treatment for anti-inflammation and for arthritis. So you can grow them here in Southern California and even raise it for homeopathic and medicinal purposes. It's actually pretty big. These are the rambling vines of Thylacema esculenta, which is a marama bean. There's an unripe pod with a couple seeds in it. There's the leaf, which reminds many of you immediately of Bauhinia. In fact, it was classified as Bauhinia. Think of the beautiful flowering trees, Bauhinia, until just recently. There I am with a one-year-old tuber, which I have dug up with the San people in Botswana. And there I am with a tuber that's probably 3 years old. Now, if you ever saw the movie, The Gods Must Be Crazy, I made mention of it last night. There were tubers that were really huge that these people were digging up, and it's an edible tuber. The bigger it gets, the more fibers in it, but it's sweet, delectable, and said it tastes like the heart of an artichoke. Not Jerusalem artichoke, but the heart of an artichoke. So that sounds pretty delicious. The nuts are also a valuable food plant. This is Oroxolon alatum, a lemony lime tasting ephemeral annual that springs up after the rains in Botswana, Namibia. And they just take it and eat the whole clump of it. My pursuit was the seeds because I think it's a wonderful vegetable to be, but I never got it because it was still in flower. Nature doesn't always cooperate. This is a larger tuber of the marama bean. This right here is a tuber called Raphionacme, which is in the milkweed family. It's really amazing that the milkweed family is so promising as a food resource for humankind. In South Africa, this is the difference between life and death in drought years, because the tuber fills with water, weighs 20, 30 pounds, has all water in it, and so the bushmen would dig it up and they'll cut it into pieces and chew it and get their sustenance and their water requirements for the day. There are an incredible number of plant species known as cereopegias and brachystelmas that grow in South Africa that produce edible raw tubers that are now becoming rather rare because they were harvested and because their native lands are being destroyed for modern agriculture. This is an extraordinarily interesting picture because I'm eating a carrot-like root of something which is known as Cucumis kalahariensis. It is a cucumber vine that produces a large, white, delectable, succulent, carrot-like root. It could be grown in deserts all over the world that are subtropical, and it is not. Why? Why is no one inspired? This is, I showed this last night, this is a fruit of Acanthosicus snowdenianus, the gem spot cucumber. Here I'm with my daughter. There we are learning how to eat them because they're very acrid when they're raw, or most of them are acrid. Some of them actually taste like oranges, but again, they have to know where they're coming from to pick out the good raw ones in nature. They roast them in ashes, and there they start eating them. They just take the skin off and just suck it out, or they pop a little part off and just suck out the innards, and there I am with my spoon pretending to be civilized. This right here is Welwitschia. This was one of my great dreams. I waited 30 years to go to the Namibian plains to see this plant. And when I finally saw it, I started crying because it's probably a 2,000-year-old plant, maybe 1,500 years for this giant. Two leaves emerge. It's a gymnosperm. It also is called the Boinaga. The Boinaga was eaten by the various people, including the Hero people and the San Bushmen, because they realized that the root was delectable and could be roasted. It could be a crop if we were to properly cultivate it. We won't dig out a 2,000-year-old one. Here's the team going into the sand dunes near Swakopmund in Namibia. This is where one of the most unusual plants in the world grows, and certainly a bizarre fruit. But listen carefully, because this fruit undoubtedly will grow in sandy soil here in this southern part of California. And I have seeds in a refrigerator back in Michigan. So here we are with the film team. There's the plant growing on these mounds. Now wait till you see what it looks like. Here I am with the butter pits. The locals, the Hero people, harvest these, take the seeds out, roast them, ship them to South Africa. As we would eat pumpkin seeds, they eat what's known as the butter pit, the seed of Acanthosicus horridus. There we are. See, you can see a few of the fruit hiding in the plant. Now why is this plant so interesting? This is a cucumber vine that has no leaves. Its leaves have then been converted to spines. Photosynthesis occurs in an entire plant. It's a perennial. It sends down a taproot in these dunes to the source of water, maybe up to 100 feet deep. There we are. The fruits are pretty damn big. They're about like a very small watermelon. So there my daughter and I with some of our collection. She's exhausted. I'm sitting there admiring the fruit. And then here's what it looks like. There we are with some of the bounty. There is a fruiting plant. Look, covered with spines, Acanthosicus horridus, the Nara melon, N-A-R-A. There's one at the end of this in this barren dune. I thought that was a pretty cool picture. And there's the flowers. You can see the cucurbit, they're squash-like flowers. Those are male flowers there. There I am with another one. Here's my Kalahari buffet. And there's the butter pip seeds. There's the Nara melon right there. There's two Nara melons. There's the gem box cucumbers. These are tubers of Phokias. This is the marama bean tuber. There's the seed of the marama bean. There's the pods. There's this. There's the catclaw. And there is a succulent milkweed again. This one you probably have heard of called Hoodia, Hoodia gordonii. It was a rave a few years ago. They were going to put it into shake. What's the name of that kind of protein nutrition shake that's very popular? Procter & Gamble was incorporating the dietetic properties because it suppresses appetite into one of the famous nutrition beverages. So there's the Nara melon, the fruit, the inside, it tastes kind of like a milky papaya, the gem spot cucumber. There I am with the bounty in the seeds of the Nara melon. And here's one of the scenes you see in Namibia. Driving south back into South Africa, we were actually astounded to see the wild herd of I don't even know what you call a troop of giraffes. There's a specific name for them, but we saw a bunch of giraffe. There's some of these extraordinary milkweed plants again. There it is, Junia gordonii, showing you the natural habitat, peeling off the spines. And then this is a really spectacular plant, an edible plant. It is a parasite. It grows by attaching itself with a mechanism known as a haustorium. Kind of think of it as a vampire sucker or lamprey type attachment to another plant. And that right there is the remnant of the flower, Hymenura africana. This right here, about the size of a large of a tennis ball at this stage, will get as big as a grapefruit. And they're hard at that point. And this is the stem which I've uncovered growing in the sand. Hymenura africana is so relished by the people who know it that they fight the jackals to get it first. It's an extraordinary fruit. It's a parasite, but strangely enough, we have evidence that it can be cultivated. A guy by the name of Sherwin Carlquist, who was an ecologist and also a botanist, brought some seeds back from Africa, and he kind of rubbed them on the base of a euphorbia here in Southern California. And he basically forgot about it. Well, 5 years went by, and one day he goes out, and when you see what this flower looks like, you'll understand that I'm not being vulgar. Some people call it let's just do it this way. You have to go online and look at flowers of Hymenura africana, and I'll tell you how to spell it once you give me a critique. It turns out that it looks very much like a female body part when it's blossoming, and hence, when he saw these blooming, he was absolutely amazed, and this incredible plant was growing and blooming, and it had attached itself to the euphorbia, which also are from South Africa, so it was a proper host plant, leading me to believe that we can cultivate these. There it is from a little bit more distance, holding a pink one. This is an unripe one, which has been cut open and turned into a giant fig-like fruit underground. Really would be something amazing. Okay, I cannot believe this, because now I have like 15 minutes to give questions. I'm not usually able to do this. Thank you, I'm so happy. I really not talk so much. Okay, so there is the address again, greatgardenspeakers.com. I'll leave that there so you can take that down. I have a website as well, which I'm going to show you that, and I have an email because you will want to write me and talk with me. We have a few minutes then to answer questions, and I would really like to have you pick my brain. Just throw it out there. If I'm able to handle it, I'll answer. If not, I'll just decline. Steve, you get the first one. Okay, let's do it this way. Ask a question, I'll repeat it. Because we're so big, come up here, ask me the question, and I'll repeat it. And anyone else with a question, just come up here real quick. We'll go through some questions quick. Okay, so he said that the question is this. Lots of members of the milkweed family have poisonous alkaloids. These alkaloids are called cardiac alkaloids. They stop the heart. Plenty of poisonous ones and plenty of toxic ones. Not all plant families are safe. Safe, in my explanation, is that you can eat all of them, like cabbage, remember, the Brassicaceae, it's almost a completely safe family. Other families have both deadly poisonous plants in their speciation and also completely edible ones. So you have to know what you're doing. That's the bottom line. So you know what your plant is, you know the ethnobotany. People ask me what I am. I claim to be an ethnobotanist. Did I go and formally study at a university? No, because I want to be a generalist. I don't want to spend 15 years of my life documenting the cardiac glycosides in milkweeds. I want to know about all the plants and all their variety and share that with as many people as possible. So people ask me, well, where did you get your PhD? I said, no one could teach me what I know. And I'm not saying that facetiously. All right, next question, please. Yes? Okay, and this is very good. So he's talking about part of the reason we are in our circumstance, in our predicament today, of not knowing about the food plants in the world, is that we have seen an extraordinary evolution of the way we eat plants. Part of it is what I call the manifestation of the white man. the colonists from Europe would supplant native tradition over and over and over again by asserting their superiority to more, maybe what they claimed, primitive people. It was maybe an intent to mimic the invaders. Maybe it was an intent to absorb their knowledge and their technologies and skills and leave behind what was appreciated. Recent and modern examples of that include quinoa. 30 years ago, it's almost unknown that people knew about quinoa because it was a dying tradition even in Bolivia. When a few people who were healthy that started growing and eating quinoa, it became a fad so much now that it is brought back in the ancient tradition. And this is what happens. If you think about North America, extraordinary case of the suppression of native knowledge. When they were invading and coming westward, the pioneers supplanted the people, supplanted their tradition, moved them around, moved them out of their habitat, and a vast amount of native knowledge was lost. With that native knowledge, you don't regain it without some concerted effort to go back and find it. So even in our wonderful North America, there are books on food plants. But the tradition, the knowledge of that use has all but dissipated, and it needs to come back by people passionate like ourselves, even incorporating native peoples now who want to go back to their tradition. Next one. Yeah. Okay, sorry.
As far as that concerted effort and your work, I'm sure you're trying to plant some trees.
Okay, so let me summarize this, and you tell me if I did a good job. There are many plants which are endangered because they have been ignored, marginalized. Maybe it's the destruction of habitat. Maybe it's the fact that they're just rare in the first place. A wonderful example is called Apios priceana. It's called Price's potato bean. It's also known as the Traveler's Delight. It's only known from a few counties in Kentucky, Tennessee, Alabama, and Mississippi. And this extraordinary rare plant should be everywhere, but because it grew on the margins of pastures in forest land, it is really endangered. The good thing is, as I contend, plants don't need to be endangered. We can mass propagate them. Somebody asked me today where they can find Edgar's Baby. Edgar's Baby is now being tended. That is the creation of Edgar Valdivia here. The wonderful dragon fruit with incredible taste profile, being grown by a company known as AgriStarts in Apopka, Florida. They're a wholesale entity, but they're producing thousands of that one plant. If they were to take Apios priceana and do tissue culture on it, they would be able to produce thousands of plants and get distributed them all over the place. So the means of multiplying plants is so efficacious today that virtually no plant needs to be rare and dangerous. Is that a good answer? If you write me, yes, I can dedicate time to answering. But there's in North America alone, there's several thousand.
So, what was the question?
The question is, can you make a list of the rare, amazing native plants that are edible, in this case in North America, that can be put on a list for all of you guys to take care of and save and spread out? Anything else?
Yes.
Bianca, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so the question is, you're going around the world and you're collecting all of this incredible biodiversity. You're finding it. What are you doing to safeguard it? How are you, what's relevant about what you're doing? And the question is interesting because I was posed that at AVRGC, the Asian Vegetable Research and Development Corporation, I was giving a talk in Changshua, Taiwan a few years back, and the director did the exact same thing to me. He says, Joe, so what are you doing with everything you're doing? I send this stuff all over the world. I give it to people all over the world in an effort to get them growing it and preserving it. The more people that I can give it to, the more I feel that I've been Johnny Appleseed, and the more that I feel that we're doing something. How much diversity do I have? In my collection, I have about 1,400 varieties of common bean. That's Phaseolus vulgaris. Some things, like the gnawer melon, I only have two or three collections. These are kept all over Europe. They're kept with people in Africa. They're kept with people in the United States. And I try to share them to seed banks and gene banks everywhere. And it's, as you can imagine, there's some type of obstacles, obstructions, and ways of getting things around. And much of it has to do with paperwork. So you can ship things to Europe, get paperwork, back to the United States, for example. There's all kinds of ways to address these things.
So, well, what about selecting a specific seed for a specific species? What method do you use to try to get as much genetic diversity?
Okay, like the gagfruit. I've collected gagfruit in Vietnam. I've collected it in Cambodia, in Laos, and in Borneo. There's a huge amount of diversity there, and I have my eyes on the Andaman Islands and on eastern India. So, I mean, yes, I try to get as much diversity as possible and share it with people. I have so many seeds I can't give them away. I have 14,000 accessions of vegetable and fruit seeds. Yes, thank you.
So, I really enjoyed your presentation, and it was extremely inspiring. You kept saying, why aren't we growing this here? Why aren't we growing this here? Why aren't we growing this here? Some of us do want to grow it here, but we're kind of the common man. How does the common man need to get access to this, and what do you
mean? Okay, the first thing, I mean, we do have a resource, and we do have networks. How do common people find this really rare, amazing thing? Well, it is true. There is a book called Cornucopia, which you can still buy on Amazon, and it is compiled by Steve Fasciola. It was supposed to be a source book for approximately 3,000 varieties and species of edible plant. Still wonderful, somewhat outdated because many things have changed. You're going to have to come up so I can hear you, I think, in terms of the question. So, that said, I will have a website here, and my goal is to build networks. I have another project called Gardens Across America, where I send seeds of rare things all over America to gardeners who grow them out. They give me back 50% of seeds, which I share with other gardeners. And now my only problem is there's too much for me to handle. I need a team of people. I'm looking for finance to do that, and I think we're going to have it. Gentlemen.
Last night you mentioned the seed bank that we might be able to acquire some of the items that you've shown. Since I'm planning on leaving some feedback, there's a few of those that I might be interested in.
Yes. Now, okay, so there's several issues here. Many of the plants that were collected, I did not find seeds on that were in this particular thing, but that does not mean there are not sources. Like Hoodia gordonii, you can go right to one of the succulent nurseries in Vista, California. In fact, there's a gentleman raising commercial quantities of Hoodia gordonii. And the drink I was trying to bring up was SlimFast. So Procter & Gamble tried to incorporate the concentrated Hoodia gordonii as a dietary ingredient into SlimFast, and when they did, they found it chemically decomposed and was useless. So, yeah, writing on the website will also be very good. So, let's see here. Wait a second, okay. Okay, so there's that. There's my website, explorewithjoseph.com. I'll leave that up for a second, and that will have ways of contacting me, that will have network projects. It shows my expeditions around the world, and I mean, the goal, Christine, who is my executive assistant, she is trying to help me label all those expeditions from all the world, over a couple hundred of them, in 5 minutes. So they're good, really, really good. Yes, please. All right, how do you get through customs? Well, let's put it this way. I do not risk going through customs because I don't want to be behind bars. That doesn't mean I haven't transcended, but that also tells me that nature is pretty, pretty effective at getting seeds around. So a lot of times I have them in my intestinal tract. Did I just say that? I haven't done that before. I really have done that. And the technique, as you can imagine afterward, begs description. Ziploc bags are very, very good for that purpose, and a little bit of bleach. So that's what we do. Now, I know, I mean, I'm being somewhat facetious, okay? So it is true, I have done that, and I give some good examples. I have a tomato breeder friend who is like a genius. I call him Michelangelo Tomatoes, and he would not give me seeds, but he said, Joe, you can eat whatever you want out here. I ate 6.5 pounds of tomatoes that week, and I will confess, because it'll become notorious, I actually cleaned the residue and collected the seeds, and I had all of those tomatoes. That was true. I got it. So what you will usually do is there will be techniques, that's dedication. There will be techniques to getting seeds, like for example, Malaysia. Think of it this way. If I went to the government and asked them if I could have seeds of their tropical durian, they would say, no, you can't ship these out of the country, but I can go to the market and I can buy fruit, right? So why can't I keep the seeds of my fruit? So I took the fruit and I packed them up in big styrofoam containers, And then I flew to a country like Norway or a country like Holland where they appreciate fruit lovers. So I come into the customs with like five big styrofoam boxes of fruits, and the custom agents come up and they said, so what are you doing? I said, well, we're going to have a fruit party. I said, I'm going to see Chef Marco. Oh, you're going to see Chef Marco? And they let me in with 500 pounds of fruit. So when I got in that way, then I said, okay, I'm going to be eating a lot of fruit from now on. So I'm selling boxes of fruit all over the world. And it's true. And so there's ways to get around bureaucracy to make it legitimate. There are companies. Think of what I said about Holland. Holland is the biggest agricultural exporter in the world. You probably didn't know it, but they are the second largest exporter of oranges in the entire world. They don't raise oranges in Holland, but they bring them in from all over the world, pack them, and ship them back out. So they're extremely efficient bureaucratically. That means I can ship seeds from all over the world into Holland. They can get phytosanitary permits on them through the Dutch government. And guess what? They can ship them anywhere in the world. So you just have to know how to do it. That's in a nutshell. Is that it?
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Joe.